Okay. So our penultimate speaker this afternoon is Christopher Hall. He works with me in the Babraham Institute Flow. How have we written it on here? Babraham Institute Flow Cytometry Facility. So Chris has worked here for 2 years. Before that, he's worked in a number of different cores. Now, Chris speaks a different language to me. He speaks the language of R. And it's something I don't understand, but it's very useful when you have projects that you want to do. So I say to him things like, wow, we've run a lot of samples on a lot of machines. That's going to take ages to do data analysis. It's all right, I've written an R program. Or, Chris, I want to do bingo. How are we going to do bingo? It's all right, I've written an R program. So Chris is going to tell you today about some of the stuff he uses R for and spectral.
Thank you, Rachel. And so it's actually Python, not R, for the bingo cards. But it's close enough. And so, back to the future, unlocking your cytometer's full potential. How many people here actually have a full spectrum flow cytometer? So Aurora, Bigfoot, SA, A5, SE. Half, probably? Probably about half? So I'm going to argue you all have machines that are capable of the capabilities of a full spectrum flow cytometer. So each current on the market, actually, let's go through the slides. So the plan is to look through full spectrum flow cytometer very quickly, because Peter's already described the maths behind it, but I'll do it even simpler. And we'll look at the principles and how we can apply them to our own machines. And so we're going back to the future, like Doc Brown and Marty McFly here. Sorry, what was that? Bingo. Hello. We have someone is going to win 1 kilogram of Skittles. Congratulations. Do we have any more bingo prizes, Rachel? There you go, the one winner. Yeah, so I'm going to talk about you enabling your conventional machines with spectral capabilities and how you actually do this yourself. And so there is a bit of similarity to what I said at Flow UK, but this is all new data today rather than what we showed yesterday, last time. And so we have these four machines. We have the BD A5SE, is it? The Aurora, the ID7000, the Bigfoot, and these are our full spectrum machines. But none of them are really full spectrum in the way that I would think about it. They look at entire spectrums from the laser line to about 800 nanometers, but they all partition their spectra differently. Some are 40 nanometers, some are 5 nanometer bandpasses or grated PMTs, and some, like the BD machine, there's some 40 nanometer bandpass filters in there. But it's still spectral. It's spectral because of the unmixing algorithms rather than the actual instrumentation itself. As Professor Robinson said it before, they would analyze the data well after acquiring it because the maths was difficult or the processing was difficult. And so if you process your conventional data in a spectral way, you'll get some surprising results. So very quickly, traditional compensation, traditional instrument, you have band passes, these you measure in the single, the peak emission in each detector, and you do the compensation to remove this overlap. We all know this. And equally with spectral unmixing, we have lots of detectors, we use every single detector. We then unmix or deconvolute or demix the signal to produce individual fluorophores. We assign the photons to the correct fluorophore and then we can analyze the data. And as Peter pointed out, there is lots of ways of doing this. There are many ways of doing this, and each way will produce very slightly different results, which is quite interesting. We'll show that in a second. But what we have here is this conceptual idea that compensation is perfect and unmixing is imperfect. So that we use the least, people talk about weighted least squares or least squares unmixing. And this is just a process of choosing the best unmixing algorithm for your data. It has nothing to do with the process. Well, it has something to do with the process. What I'm trying to say is that what we're trying to do is find the best fit for your data. But actually, you can move this line to the top, move it to the right, change the angle, and you can actually look at visualize your data in a different way depending on how you unmix. And so what we have here are the filter patterns of the three machines. I don't have the ID7000 here because when I made this, I didn't know what the bandpasses were or the grated PMTs. But of the A5SE, the Bigfoot, and the Aurora, And we can see they have different conceptual filter configurations. The Aurora has lots of 14-ish nanometer filters, not so much in the blue areas. The Bigfoot has more detectors in the yellow-green area for some reason, if we go down here, but less in the far red. And the A5SE has almost no separation in filter patterns in the UV regions, but they have a lot in the violet because obviously they have all the BV dyes. And so this is interesting because actually the Bigfoot and the A5SE look like a traditional flow cytometer with the way they segregate their spectra. And so this is something we're going to see a lot, and we've already seen a lot today. This is Fitzy from an Aurora, and we already know here we have the spectral plot. We've got some blue excitation, blue emission. So the blue laser excites the fluorophore. It emits at, what, 530, 550 nanometers. And this is what we see here, but we also see these other emissions, which is their spectral pattern. This is what we are unmixing. And this is an Attune, also looking at Fitzy. And yes, the Attune is this particular one is a 4-laser, 14-detector Attune. A lot lower density data, let's say. But we still have a pattern. We have the 530 emission here from the blue laser. We have a little bit of emission here from the violet laser, and possibly a little bit from the red, but this might be the way I set it up. But it's still a spectral pattern. And so if you have multiple spectral patterns, there's nothing stopping you from unmixing the data as an alternative to compensation. And so here we have a competition. We have a fight between the Aurora and the Attune. The Aurora is on the left, the Attune is on the right. And this is it a 9-color panel? I've done this up to 12 colors in the Attune, which I think is quite good. We've got the forward and side scatter. We look at the live dead 4-red, so we're taking the negative populations. This is unmixed, by the way. This is not compensated. This is unmixed data. We can separate out of CD3 and CD19. We have this classical, really negative events. If I see this on people's Aurora data, we would say they've got an unmixing error, but we can still see the populations and they're very comparable. Here we have CD8, CD4, classic, really easy to visualize, and we get really good CD25 resolution. And this is unmixed on a 14 parameter Attune instrument. And so, yeah, so you think, okay, that's fine, because the whole point of unmixing is you have more detectors than parameters. It's an overdetermined system. So any system that has less fluorophores than detectors is overdetermined, so you can do the unmixing. But the question is, why would you want to do it? And the answer is that most people, even on the Auroras, apart from maybe Oliver, really don't utilize the entire capability of the machine, even these full spectral machines. And because of that, you can do interesting computational tasks, such as autofluorescent subtraction, which I heard a lot about today. We can unmix similar fluorophores, and we can fix common setup mistakes. And so here's a bit of an unfair example for them, but this is APC and A-Fluor 780. So here's, Alexa 4647 and APC. And we can see this is the normalized spectra. We can see they're extremely similar. There's a little bit of difference on the APC here. So APC has this UV emission. And people knew about this UV emission, 10, 15 years ago when the UV started to come on the LSR? And when you look at a traditional spectral plot, you don't see the UV emission because they're only showing you the red line. And the emission lines never went into the UV region, so no one ever saw it. But on the LSR, you used to be able to see it, and people were always confused that you had to compensate from the UV with APC. And so this is Bigfoot data. It's not great. The Bigfoot is a nice machine, but the Aurora beats it in the fact it has an extra detector. It has a sneaky little detector. This has a 670, a 619, a 700-ish detector, which means they can separate out APC and AF647 really easily because they have a 10 nanometer shift in emission. But we can see it here. These are real cells from an actual experiment, so it's a bit unfair. There's other colors in here. But the question is, if we apply the same unmixing to a Fortessa, can we separate out APC and Alexa 4647? And the answer is yes, you can. Because this is the Fortessa, 18 detected Fortessa, and we can still see here the emissions from the UV here, the 405 here, on APC is clearly visible on the Fortessa. And if you apply unmixing to Fortessa data, I mean, this is particularly nice data, almost perfect data, but you can unmix AF607 and APC on a Fortessa, which was the killer feature. It was the big marketing thing that we always used to hear, that you could do APC and AF607. But it's actually possible on a traditional machine if you set it up correctly. That was meant to be a head exploring symbol, but obviously this computer doesn't have any emojis on it. It must be Windows XP or something like that. Never mind. And so we can also fix bad setups. So this is what I showed last time I talked about this, is that if you incorrectly set up your machine with a traditional compensation, you get data that looks like poop. So we can, so this is NK1.1 and Li6G, should be nicely separated, should be on a single axis here. And here we have 11B and Li6G again. And these should be square populations. There should be doubled expression here, but it just looks awful. And that's because it's badly set up. So this is from a Pentium. And it's badly set up because we haven't adjusted the voltages correctly. We haven't made sure its brightness is on channel or the normal stuff that we do. But with unmixing, you just care about the pattern. You don't care about the way it's set up necessarily. And so with exactly the same data, unmixed, we rescue the data. And suddenly we have a capability of when our when your students or anyone else badly sets up an experiment, by applying unmixing principles rather than traditional compensation, we can actually rescue the data. There are caveats to this, which I'll talk about in a second, but this is the compensation matrix of this data, and then there's lots of high, very high numbers, 70 there, 70 there, 101 there. Correct, but we end up with a bit of a mess. But I will say that the Liston Labs autospell algorithm from Carlos Rocca and the rest in the lab is actually fantastic at rescuing bad data. So if you haven't used it before on traditional machines, you can, it's baked into FlowDraw. And actually quite often, if you have issues like this, if you run autospell instead, which is a linear compensation algorithm, it actually does a really good job of fixing this, but not in this case. And so the other thing we do is autofluorescence subtraction. So I've got work in progress here. So I have proof of concept data and kind of I've artificially created different autofluorescences from cells, and I can prove it works, but I don't want Elizabeth Bick to tweet me and say that this data is fake. So I'm not going to show you, but we're trying to work on getting better autofluorescence data. But your traditional machines, the newer ones, have all been designed around the BV dyes. And so those BV dyes mean that you have a lot of violet detectors. So you got some have the 430, the 450, the 470, the 500, the 550. These detectors mean that actually you can see a lot of autofluorescence in your traditional machine. And you can apply the same, I can't prove it right here, but you should be able to apply the same autofluorescence retraction routines to your traditional machines. Having said that, you're going to be using up a lot of detectors and the machine should still be overdetermined. So you've got to weigh the number of parameters with how much autofluorescence you have. And so we've been working on a little project, and here I have unmixed multiple machines. What is this? 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 machines here. We've also done the ZE5, done the Aurora, not the Aurora, the Fusion and the RE, which are very similar. And what we do is we open all the channels and we do our own cytic assay settings or our own setting the baseline. And by keeping all the channels open, we can do spectral unmixing. And so we have the Aurora, this is the same cells. Not quite the same day, once some of them are the next day, but they were fixed. And we can see from the Aurora and the ID7000, these are the spectral truth, I suppose. And then we have the Symphony, the Pentium, the Attune, Cytoflex, and Fortessa. And you can see how similar the data is. But what I would like to point out is that the Aurora and ID7000 actually produce slightly different results. And across all of these, even though the data looks very similar, there are very slight differences in percentages, big one here. And this comes back to this unmixing algorithm idea, is that there is no perfect answer to your unmixing. When you do the least squares or the weighted least squares or whichever one you want to choose, actually, there is no correct answer as to what the best unmixing is. So as you perform it on different machines, the algorithm will choose different points. And even between these two machines, which we are both conventional full spectrum flow cytometers, the same machine produced slightly different results. And so this is something you've really got to think about, something Paul touched on, is that because there are so many ways of unmixing, and something we really need to think about is unlike, say, with CS&T settings where you used to be able to compare the LSR, the Fortessa, and the Symphony. Can you do it between an ID7000 and an Aurora? You probably can't. Not without some more thought. Yeah, there you go. There's that plat again. And so if you want to do this yourself, it's really simple. We turn on all the channels. You run your Unmixing control and set a baseline setting. So on the BD machines, I love using the application setting worksheet to be able to set the baselines. But basically, you put it to the negative region, whatever the manufacturer recommendation is. Run the same samples, make sure on scale. Something people haven't talked about today at all is on full spectrum flow cytometry. If things go off scale, it's a disaster. Don't let anything ever go off scale when you're doing full spectrum flow cytometry. And then run your samples and make sure the brightness is on channel. I say not necessary because obviously we talked about a second ago about rescuing bad data, but in reality, if you don't do this properly, you end up with data like this. So this is the same experiment, but slightly wrong setting. So these are beads, okay? And so the beads fluoresce quite brightly in the violet channels off the violet laser. And the default settings on the Fortessa ends up, particularly with the BV711 channel, very high. So this is negative, which is insane, but it's brighter than my positive for my APC channel. And so actually when you normalize the plot, you end up with this massive overabundance of data that kind of overwhelms and kind of just takes the Unmixing and says, everything is from this channel. And actually, then you can't separate out the data. But if you set the settings up right and bring this back down, we end up with the normalized plots we saw before, and we can actually separate out the APC and AF647 on a normal machine. And if you do this yourself, these two are particularly problematic, as you can imagine. PERCP 5.5 and eFlow 710, they have a very broad emission. And most machines set the violence quite tight, because you saw the cytic acid settings where you have these little humps. And that's there to get past the fact that a lot of cells have kind of violet emission. And so when you set it up yourself, you have to do some sort of analogous settings for yourself. But be particularly wary of these two channels. It's happened when I've been doing this dozens of times almost, when it hasn't worked very well because of these two combinations. And so how did I do this? So it was all in R, as Rachel said. To do an Unmixing in R is really simple, like critically simple. We get the coefficients, as we saw just before. We take our controls, our expression data, and this is basically your result. This is the result. It's one line. I mean, it's not one line because you have to import the data, but it's really not difficult because it's something that's been established over decades of maths. This is not new. It's just new to flow cytometry. And so what you've been seeing today, so for the Unmixing, I've made a little R script, a little R program that will do the Unmixing for you. It will even try and predict the positive populations, which is very useful. And all the plots you've been seeing today from the quiz and from this presentation are something called Flow Spectrum, which is a single line bit of R code that will output spectral plots. And this is particularly important, as I said, and I saw those FCS Express plots. And actually the commercial software, none of them really produce good spectral plots. None of them do. I don't understand. I hope something I don't use produces good spectral plots. But outside of the manufacturers and acquisition software, nothing really seems to do it very well. And that also expands to the fact that you can't put Sony files on the Aurora. You can't put Bigfoot files on the Sony. You can't put A5SE files on anything. That's not true. You can put it in FlowDraw. But you can't compare the different spectra from different machines without having it on third-party software. And so that's why this was made in the first place. And that is the end of my talk. So thank you very much. Any questions?
We have loads of Skittles left, so please ask questions. Heaven.
Oh, I'm going to say yes to your question from the email.
Really nice talk. Thanks, Chris. And I've used your two R packages, and I can tell everyone that they're fantastic. Yeah. My question was, so you say that there isn't one perfect answer to and getting your inverse matrix. Can we get convergence statistics from these methods to tell us at least how good of a job or some way of measuring how good the unmixing is?
That's interesting. So the reason I made the flow unmix in the first place was to copy David Novo and Bartek's paper, I can't remember who the third author was, and recreate, because they had lots of unmixing methods. And I wanted to recreate that paper to see how it worked. And then you look up, there's the weighted algorithms where they weight on certain detectors. But there are ways of looking at the unmixing and trying to reduce the variation. And I believe the Sony might do that, but I'm not 100% sure. There is ways. I can send you an email about what it is, but I can't remember what it is off the top of my head.